Psalm 41 is on page 560 of our church Bibles, 560. So let's read it together. Psalm number 41. Blessed are those who have regard for the weak. The Lord delivers them in times of trouble. The Lord protects and preserves them. They are counted among the blessed in the land. He does not give them over to the desire of their foes. The Lord sustains them on their sick bed and restores them from their bed of illness. I said, have mercy on me, Lord, heal me, for I have sinned against you. My enemies say of me in malice, when will he die and his name perish? When one of them comes to see me, he speaks falsely, while his heart gathers slander. Then he goes out and spreads it around. All my enemies whisper together against me. They imagine the worst for me, saying a vile disease has afflicted him. He will never get up from the place where he lies. Even my close friend, someone I trusted, one who shared my bread, has turned against me. But may you have mercy on me, Lord. Raise me up that I may repay them. I know that you are pleased with me, for my enemy does not triumph over me. Because of my integrity, you uphold me and set me in your presence forever. Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Amen and amen. Now, just a word of warning. Let's get ready in advance. We're going to be turning to John chapter 13 later on during the talk. Why not keep something in the page there at the psalm. Flip over to page 1079. Put a little bookmark in there so you can turn over to it easily later on. And then come back to the start of Psalm 41 with me. All prepared? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, our prayer is that you would speak to us through your word once again this morning. We long for your spirit to warm our hearts and to continue to change our lives to be more and more like our Lord Jesus. And that's our prayer today, that you would do that. We ask in his name. Amen. Now, I'm not pretending for a moment this morning that I sit around reading the Greek classics like Homer's Odyssey in the evenings, like I'm sure some of you do. Which means I generally have to rely on TV shows like Madam Secretary for any rare little bits of culture that I actually pick up. And so it was a guy on Madam Secretary through the week who told the ancient story of the homecoming of Ulysses, the king, 20 long years after he set out to do battle with Troy. Ulysses was coming home. And seeing that on TV, it actually inspired me to look it up and read a little more. It's a great story. Ulysses is battle weary and 20 years older than when he left home. And on his way home, he's been shipwrecked off the coast. So here he is in rags, the king, unrecognizable, weakened, battered, almost beyond recognition. And Ulysses starts walking towards the city, his palace. Along the way, of course, nobody knows who he is. He's taken for a beggar. He links up with a pig keeper, Eumaeus, who offers him food and then walks with him towards the town. The people who see them are jeering. One guy laughs and calls out to them, look what we've got here, one piece of filth sticking to another piece of filth. Old pig keeper, what are you taking that garbage to the palace for? All he'll get there is a sound beating. Now remember, this is the king that he's talking about, but Ulysses doesn't say a word. Even another beggar abuses him. People pelt him with rotten food, and still he doesn't say a word. As they're passing by the rubbish tip on the edge of town, there's a sad old dog lying in the rubbish. Argos, who years before was one of the king's finest hunting hounds. And Argos, the faithful dog, smells his scent and lifts his head and wags his tail, the only one who knows the king for who he is. And then Argos happily finally dies. Now look, you can figure out the rest. They come into the palace, the abuse gets worse and worse because in his humble circumstances, nobody recognises the king. And of course, in the end, when everything finally becomes clear, the way they have treated him is an indication of the way they treat everyone in poor circumstances. And justice finally prevails and everyone cheers. Now, if you stand back and look at that story, that is pretty much the scene here in Psalm 41. It's a song by King David that paints a picture of a sick and weakened king. Verses 1 to 3 state the general principle, particularly verse 1, that God is on the side of the weak, which means the godly will be on the side of the weak too. Before then, verses 4 to 10 make it clear that the sick and weakened one at this point is King David himself. And the big question in the psalm is, how will you treat this king when you meet him in his weakness? Because that's going to count for a lot when you meet him in his strength. How are you going to treat this King David in his weakness? That's the question the psalm asks. A chance for rebellion, an invitation to slander and betrayal. All those options are here in this song of a weak and lowly king. So here's the principle spelled out in the opening words of verse 1. Blessed are those who have regard for the weak. Because that's not always the way, is it? In the dog-eat-dog world we live in. Even more red in tooth and claw back in David's day. In a world around us built on the principle of the survival of the fittest, it's very easy to fall into the habit of walking over the weak on your way to the top. You might not actually be pelting rotten food, but David says, blessed are those who take notice, who have regard for the weak, instead of taking advantage. Because the Lord says, I'm on their side, the weak ones, and I'll deliver them. Verse 2, notice, he protects and preserves them, the weak. He doesn't give them over to the desires of their foes, who just see it as an opportunity. See, this is one of the astonishing things about the Old Testament, that Israel is meant to be a place after God's own heart, and that the same God who put the stars into place looks down and comforts and protects the smallest orphan and looks tenderly on the plight of the poorest widow. He's got a heart for the poor and the displaced. The Lord sustains the sick on their sick bed, verse 3, and restores them from their bed of illness. Which then you see is what David himself relies on in his own time of need. As he cries out in verse 4, have mercy on me, Lord, heal me, for I've sinned against you. Now it's hard to know exactly the situation as David writes the psalm, but as you look back on David's life story in the book of 2 Samuel, there is a string of examples of times when David is laid low specifically because of his adultery with Bathsheba and all the crimes that follow. And that has ongoing consequences. Doesn't mean that every time you're sick, it's because you've sinned. But in David's case, it's very appropriate that he's starting out with a prayer of repentance. He's wanting things to be right with God. And so he starts from that point of humility. Because he needs help. His enemies are circling around him like sharks that smell blood in the water. Because they don't have regard for the weak at all. They just see it as an opportunity. This time last year, Vladimir Putin cancelled a visit to Kazakhstan, and a junior Kazakh official made the mistake of saying publicly, it looks like he's unwell. Probably just a head cold, but the media went into a frenzy. That was March 5 last year. Then he skipped another meeting the next week, and then another one, March 18, by which time the rumours were saying he was dead or at the very least critically ill. And the Kremlin tried to deny it, and they released a video of a meeting they said happened on March 10, and people just wouldn't believe it. They were blowing up still frames from the video, trying to read the date on the desk calendar to prove it was a faked video, and that Putin really was dead. See, when you are in a position of power and influence, it doesn't pay to show weakness. As soon as there's blood in the water, the sharks will circle. And that's exactly how it is with King David. My enemies say of me in malice, verse 5, when will he die and his name perish? When will we be rid of him? And they spread rumours. They are making the most of every opportunity because they want to use his weakness to bring him down. Forgetting the fact from verse 1 that blessed are those who have regard for the weak, they're trying to use his weakness against him. Which means, of course, they are on very thin ice. Read from verse 6, because this is not the kind of visitor you want in your hospital room, is it? Oh, here are your flowers. Let me have a look at your chart so I can spread some dark rumours on Facebook. When one of them comes to see me, he speaks falsely while his heart gathers slander. Then he goes out and spreads it around. And in verse 7 and 8, they're spreading malicious rumours in the hope of destabilising his rule. All my enemies whisper together against me. They imagine the worst for me, saying a vile disease has afflicted him. He will never get up from the place where he lies. You know the worst thing? It's not just his enemies. It is his closest friend. It is one who shares his table. Don't know if you've ever known a feeling of betrayal like that, someone you trusted letting you down. But David, when he is down, even his friends are kicking him, giving up on him, walking out on him, turning against him. You know the feeling? I just paid a quick visit to an online forum for people who were sharing their stories of hurt and betrayal. One said, "My best mate slept with my fiancée, Lisa. He betrayed me. I found out at my birthday party." For another, "In high school, all my friends took my ex-boyfriend's side when we broke up, even though he was cheating on me. The one person I needed on my side was my twin sister, but even she left with the crowd." Or this one, "My girlfriend dumped me for my best friend when I was in hospital." You know the feeling? Well, David certainly did. Read it there in verse 9. "Even my close friend, someone I trusted, one who shared my bread, has turned against me." Now, keep in mind, our series is Sing with Jesus, a fresh look at this Old Testament book of Psalms in the light of the way the New Testament quotes them. The last few weeks we've been in the Gospel of Luke, and we've seen that Jesus himself says that he's the fulfillment of not just the law, not just the prophets, but the Psalms as well. And so we've seen in Luke's Gospel the way Luke as a writer is hammering home that idea time after time after time. So it's interesting to see that John, in his Gospel, does exactly the same. So with the thought in mind from the psalm that God is the God who delivers the weak, that God is the God who preserves and sustains and restores, with the thought that blessed are those who have regard for the weak, yet King David surrounded his time of weakness by friends that turn against him. With those things in mind, we're turning to John chapter 13, and it's worth flipping over now to page 1079 of your church Bible as we meet King Jesus, the weak. And it's troublesome, isn't it? At least the disciples thought so. This is the time Jesus rips off his outer robe and puts a towel around his waist and works his way around the room on his knees, washing the smelly, road-grimed feet of his disciples. And it's even more bizarre because verse 3, if you look at it, says at this point, Jesus knows that the Father has put all things under his power. And somehow because of that, it triggers him to do the least powerful thing you could possibly imagine. He does the slave thing. He does the thing that no one else in the room would even think about stooping to do for everyone else. Jesus is lowering himself to the point of absolute weakness and humility, humiliation in front of his followers. If you read the chapter closely, Peter objects. But Jesus insists because it's a sign, he says, it is a symbol, it is a pointer to an even bigger humiliation that's coming on the cross that is going to make them even cleaner. Peter, get used to it. This is upside down leadership. This is what God's power is going to look like in its purest expression. Because God is the God who, if you remember the psalm, God is the God who loves to lower himself and stand beside the little guy. Look, it's interesting, there's a growing strand in secular leadership literature that says leaders have got to get their hands dirty. Leaders have got to serve their people. That leaders need to come down from their ivory towers and do what they call inverting the pyramid and serve their organisational business from the bottom up. Of course, Donald Trump hasn't read that stuff, but Jesus pioneered it. So verse 12 to 14, he says to his disciples, "You've seen how I served, so you do the same. Do it." Except there is one at the Passover table that night who's just not persuaded at all. His name is Judas. And he's not going to do any serving. In fact, just the opposite. Now, there have been whole books written about his motivation. What actually drove Judas to do what he's about to do? But maybe, you see, it's just that he despised all the weakness. Maybe it was just sheer disappointment that the one he thought was going to be Israel's Messiah was just a soppy servant instead. Judas has had enough. He's been one of the 12, one of the inner circle. He and Jesus have been mates, but he has made up his mind. And Jesus, maybe in a sense, you see, forewarned by the psalm, Jesus says to them, "You'll be blessed if you serve one another, but I'm not talking about all of you. Because I chose you guys and I know you. This is to fulfill," he says, John 13, verse 18, "this is to fulfill this passage of Scripture, the words of our psalm, Psalm 41, verse 9. He who shared my bread has turned against me." Verse 21, he makes it even clearer. Have a look. "After he had said this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and testified, 'Very truly, I tell you, one of you is going to betray me.'" And his disciples, they're just staring at one another in disbelief, saying, "Who does he mean? Which one of us would do that?" John says to Jesus, verse 25, "Lord, who is it?" To which Jesus says, "Watch this, the one I share my bread with." That's the one, verse 28. "It is the one to whom I will give this piece of bread when I've dipped it in the dish." Then, dipping the piece of bread, he very consciously hands it to Judas Iscariot, son of Simon. Then Judas, of course, goes out into the night to sell him out for 30 pieces of silver. Jesus the weak, Jesus the servant, Jesus the betrayed. But of course, here's the point. He is the incognito king. And you might look at him as he washes his disciples' feet and be thinking he's just a household servant, a nobody. You might be looking at him on the cross and say he's just rubbish, not worth a second thought. The same way they mocked Ulysses dressed as a beggar. What are you taking that garbage to the palace for? Well, because he's not garbage, he's the king. And even in his weakness, he is stronger than you can possibly imagine. And so even as he's betrayed, the point is, Jesus knows the way Psalm 41 plays out. And he knows one way or another, he's going to fulfill the words of that psalm in a way far bigger than David did. Because this psalm fits him like a glove. And so he is supremely confident, even at the point of his betrayal, because he can sing to himself the rest of the words of the psalm that you can see on the screen. "But may you have mercy on me, Lord. Raise me up so I may repay them. I know that you are pleased with me, for my enemy does not triumph over me. Because of my integrity, you uphold me and set me in your presence forever. Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Amen and amen." See, that is the confidence that took Jesus to the cross and through the cross to his resurrection and ultimately to his seat at the right hand of God. Which means, you see, when you step back and look at it, Psalm 41 is a warning that not only Judas, but anyone else who overlooks or treads down or conspires against or betrays the weak should take note of. And the fact is, hardwired into the universe is the truth that God himself stands by the weak and the small and the broken, and will ultimately, if they call on him, raise them up exactly like he has with Jesus. If you're feeling small and weak and broken, that should be a huge encouragement. The Apostle Paul says later on, we preach Christ crucified because God chose the weak to shame the strong. He says, for the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. Now, I'm not going to promise you a cartoon every week. You got one last week. You can have one this week. No guarantees for next week. It's a cartoon by Michael Lunig, which means it's pretty much guaranteed not to actually be funny, but deep. And I'm pretty sure it's his reflection on Cardinal Pell at the Royal Commission. Remember his words through the week? When asked what he knew about paedophile priest Gerald Risdale, Cardinal Pell said, "It was a sad story and it wasn't of much interest to me." He said, "The suffering was real, but I had no reason to turn my mind to what he was doing." So here's the cartoon from Michael Lunig. Lunig says, get down on your knees, if you can, and see the little person who's been waiting patiently, waiting for you to look down. Come close now. See clearly. See the tender little soul so perfectly true. Now at last, on your knees, you understand the most important thing of all. Do you get that? Psalm 41, verse 1, blessed are those who have regard for the weak. Are you maybe too high and mighty to notice the little guy? God's not. It does need a humility, doesn't it? See, the problem with Pell's style and his tone through the week, if you followed that terrible news from the Royal Commission, was that even if his own hands are clean, where was the regard for the weak and the broken? He was too high to even notice it. Doesn't Jesus show once and for all, if there's any doubt, that God is on their side? And not on the side of an institution or a cardinal who arrives in a car with bodyguards. The underlying question was, where was his regard for the weak? And can I ask you, before we throw too many stones in that direction, where is yours? See, the refugee issue, it's complicated, isn't it? And it makes you nervous. But the bottom line is, hardwired into the universe is the fact that God is on the side of the weak when they call on his name. So have regard for them. The guy struggling in the cubicle next to you at work, just somehow not keeping up. You need to look down on him in disdain, or you can help. The person at morning tea after church on a Sunday morning who you consciously avoid. Get down on your knees close enough so you can actually see the little person you so easily overlook. Honour the weak person that our world so easily despises. Care for the sick person in the time of their distress, because that is who we are and that is what we do. Simply because we remember that Jesus is the first fruits of that great turnaround, betrayed and despised in his weakness, but raised up forever in his glory by the everlasting God of Israel. John is going to lead us in prayer.
Thanks, Phil. Please join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this time this morning and for allowing us to gather together to spend time in your word. Lord, we are humbled by what we've learnt this morning. Jesus, your Son, humbling himself to serve those around him, and ultimately taking the sacrifice for us by dying on the cross for our sins. Lord, we see your hand in these verses, your unconditional love reaching out to embrace and protect the lowly and to calm and heal the weak. Lord, in a world that is so much about self, about what's in it for me, help us change from being self-centered, but instead to embed Jesus' characteristics in us. Lord, make our hearts servant hearts and make our actions more about helping others than better positioning ourselves. Lord, help us to be diligent in looking out for the weak, the small, and to have true regard for those that need to know the love and support faith in Jesus brings. Lord, we give thanks that you sent your Son as a perfect example of living your love, and praise you that through faith in him, we can live with you forever. Lord, we just pray this in Jesus' glorious name. Amen.